one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen. Amen.
Drunk as you suppose, for it is
is only 9 o'clock in the morning. Now, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Send out your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Lord, send out your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are great indeed. How manifold are your works, O Lord! The earth is full of your creatures. Lord, send out your spirit and renew the face of the earth. If you take away their breath, they perish and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created and renew the face of the earth. Lord, send out your spirit and renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord be glad in his works. Pleasing to him be my theme. I will be glad in the Lord. Lord, send out your spirit and renew the face of the earth.
Our second reading comes to us from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, who have first fruits of spirit, burn inwardly while we wait for adoption, redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. That hope that is seen is not hope, or hopes for what is seen. But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit with sighs too deep for words, and God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of God.
Oh, The Holy Gospel according to St. John. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of Truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning, because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Creator, from our Lord and Savior Jesus, and from God's Holy Spirit. Amen. Today is Pentecost, the anniversary of the day the Holy Spirit came upon the followers of Jesus gathered in an upper room in Jerusalem. They were so inspired that they rushed out into the street and began preaching about Jesus. Some 3,000 converts were made that day alone. And Bible scholars mark that day as the beginning of the church. This is our birthday. Very likely, none of this comes as news to any of you. You've heard all of this explained before. Even if Pentecost is not something you particularly wait for with excitement, you still have some sense of its significance for the church. One important feature of that first Pentecost was personal experience. The coming of the Holy Spirit upon those followers of Jesus was a profoundly individual encounter for each of them. Before the crucifixion, Jesus had told the apostles that after he left, the Holy Spirit would come. But at that point, that just seemed like simple information. On Pentecost, however, they personally encountered that Spirit, and they were changed forever. What about you? Have you ever had a personal experience of God or a personal experience of the presence of Christ that so gripped you that it empowered or inspired you to do something dramatic, perhaps make a change in the direction of life. Not so long ago, the Barna Research Group conducted a survey of regular church attendees, and they were asked if they had experienced the presence of God during the past year. A startling 48% said no. When asked if they had ever experienced the presence of God in worship, nearly two-thirds said no. Those numbers don't make me very happy. Maybe they don't make you happy either. I know that nothing we do, whether in a worship service or elsewhere, can manufacture a genuine experience of God, because it is all up to God. But I find it sad, assuming that this survey is correct, that two-thirds of those who regularly attend worship leave feeling that they've had no spiritual encounter, no personal meeting with the living Lord. I wonder if those numbers are skewed somehow because of how you and I define religious experience. On that first Pentecost, the experience of the disciples was dramatic, maybe even ecstatic. They were overcome with excitement, with enthusiasm, with a power that was beyond them. Figuratively speaking, they were set on fire. If that's what people were thinking when they were asked if they had experienced the presence of God in worship, then perhaps it's not surprising that so many said no. Some of us have had occasional experiences just like that. Perhaps at some emotion-filled moment when we surrendered our life to God. But those events do not happen every day. They don't happen every Sunday. Most of those experiences are defined in terms of our five senses, and you and I register the events of life in terms of what we can see and hear and touch and taste and smell. For the followers of Jesus at Pentecost, at least three of those senses must have been nearly overwhelmed. According to our scriptures, there was a sound like the rush of a mighty wind. That's hearing. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them. That's seeing. And likely the fire image brought the smell of burning as well. That's the third sense. If people were thinking of something like that when they were asked if they experienced the presence of God in church, then it's no surprise that many of them said no. But our theology defines experience in a fuller sense. We know there are two ways that we can know about God. The first we call natural knowledge. That's based on the observable world. It's available to anyone. And it means that we can know some things about God in essentially the way we learn about other things in our world, from observation and reason. We can look at the world and say that something this beautiful, this wonderfully arranged, with an orderly march of seasons and a reliable 24-hour cycle of day and night, must have a creator. We reason that it can't just be the result of coincidence or accident. But theology also tells us that such natural knowledge, things that can be observed through our five senses and concluded by our thought, is not enough to really know God. For that, we need what theology calls revealed knowledge. God's disclosure of the Godhead to us, that revelation by God, which shows us himself through inward, direct experiences of his presence. We know that a personal encounter with Jesus Christ within is God's most direct revelation of himself in our lives. But today, looking at those passionate disciples of Jesus who rushed out into the street to preach about him because they couldn't help themselves, you and I have to ask, how should our direct experience manifest itself? To put it another way, how should it make us feel? And how should it cause us to act? Maybe you've had an emotional religious experience, like some of us, at a church camp, or a youth rally, or a revival service, or maybe in private, and you know that that high we feel at those moments is just terrific. It's something that we always want to keep flowing. But sooner or later, there's a letdown, a time when the emotion dissipates and we begin to question whether the spiritual encounter we had was real after all. The Holy Spirit reminds us that, yes, it is real, but that emotion was never intended to be an ongoing part of the experience. The idea all along was that emotion was part of that starter set, and that it was to be replaced for the long haul by faith and trust. One of my colleagues is the director of one of our church camps. And at those week-long summer camp events, many young people have profound and dramatic religious experiences, sometimes so strong and so important that when the week is over, many of those teens are crying and do not want to leave. Then they go home, and they go to church the next Sunday. They're all fired up spiritually, and suddenly the letdown happens. That's because the church services can't duplicate the emotional experience they had in the environment of camp. So some kids begin to question whether their church is really Christian. And others start to doubt the reality of what they'd experienced just a week ago at camp. So my friend began to have a debriefing on the last morning those kids were in camp. The staff would try to prepare the kids for re-entry into their homes and families and churches. It was explained that they should not expect the emotional highs of their camp experience to continue at that same intensive level, and that they should view their congregations as working on the long haul leading to faith and trust. For most of us, if there is emotion involved in our religious experience at all, and there doesn't always have to be, it is at best the door that opens to a life of faith. Depending on our makeup, the emotion may revisit us from time to time, but for the most part, it's intended to be replaced by faith and hope and trust that hangs on even when events in life bring us low. Christian experience gives us new eyes to see the living truth of Scripture. It confirms the biblical message for our lives now. It illumines our understanding of God and creation and motivates us to make sensitive moral judgment. That's the purpose of religious experience. Not to sustain emotion, but to connect us to faith. Even the original Pentecost disciples had to find faith for the long haul. When the feelings fade, we still need to be glad that we've had the experience. For it was that which first opened the door of faith and helped us to see the truth of the Bible and its truth for us. That's what happened to 3,000 people on that original Pentecost. They heard Peter and the others preaching in the streets, interpreting Scripture in the light of Jesus Christ. And many of them listened, suddenly knew that that story was for them. God's word had become a path for them, and they reached out in trust toward a God who had been reaching to them all along. That's the long-range goal of religious experience, to make us aware that we are in the presence of God and to secure our allegiance to the one who has created and saved us. Blessed Pentecost to you. Amen.
remembrance of our baptism into Christ, we confess our faith.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Truly, we are witnesses to God's reconciliation with everyone in Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
God's peace be. Once again, a happy Pentecost to each of you. And I want to add my thanks to all of you who have worn red. It's okay to be a little crazy on Pentecost. If you are visiting here at Hollywood Lutheran today, we offer a special word of welcome to you. We invite you to complete one of the worship registration cards. You'll find it in one of the pew racks in front of you so that we might follow up. It would be especially helpful for us if you would be willing to share your email address, and you can add that to those cards, and then please place the card in one of the offering plates as it comes to you. We will soon be offering our intercessions this morning, so we ask that you remember in prayer, especially those names included in the worship bulletin today. We want to remind you about Susan and Beth and their need to receive our continuing prayers. Both of them are at home recuperating from recent hospitalizations, and they're doing well. Immediately after this worship service, we hope you'll be able to join us right next door in Hoyk Hall for some refreshments and fellowship. If your schedule allows that, we invite you to be our guest. Would you please note that the food pantry will not be open this Wednesday, but rather will be open Thursday from 11 until 1. That change is just for this week, but we call it to your attention. If you have a need, please come. If you can help by volunteering or offering a financial donation, let us know that too, please. Choir members are reminded that the rehearsal is Thursday at 7 p.m., and we also want to update you on some progress being made for plans for the columbarium here at Hollywood Lutheran. We are still seeking funding. We know that that's not inexpensive, but it is a very wonderful way to remember those who have gone before us, and it would be a beautiful addition to our church home. Please contact Tim if you have additional questions about that project as it moves forward. And then just one reminder to you on our ascending hymn today that ends worship. Please note that on verse 3, you're invited to listen to the organ and not sing, but instead meditate on the words that are there. Verse 3 only. Next week, we celebrate the festival of the Holy Trinity. We hope that you will be with us for worship here at 10 next Sunday. Again, welcome to Hollywood. Welcome to Christ. Thank you. Thank you. And joining us as a special guest in worship today is Archbishop Robert Clement from the American Catholic Church. That congregation shares our facilities here on our campus, and we are especially glad as we celebrate Pentecost, Bishop Clement, to welcome you into our midst for worship today. We thank you for your presence.
Confident that the resurrection of Christ has defeated sin and death, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. Holy God, you raise up leaders in your church to preach salvation through the death and resurrection of Christ. Inspire us to go and tell this good news throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you prayed that your people would be one. Forgive us, Lord, and take away the pride and arrogance which divide your church. Break down the walls which separate us. Unite us with your bonds of love and accomplish your will. We pray that by the power of your Spirit, your healing work would work in the body of Christ in your church, and through us to bring about the purpose of your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you make yourself known in your creation, in mountains, in valleys, in plants and animals, and in those who care for what you have made. Lead us and all your creatures to proclaim that this is the day the Lord has made. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you desire that all people live in peace. Guide all in authority at the local, state, national, and international levels, that they show no partiality in their care and concern. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you wipe away the tears of all who cry to you in distress. Console those who are afraid, protect those who are persecuted, bring healing to all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, especially Susan and Raul in the long battle with her cancer, Charles, Beth, Cecilia, John, Beverly, and Jim for healing, Nadine and Father Hans with trust in your mercy, Corinne, Joyce, and Mary, Ivy and Inger, who for wholeness and well-being, Raul Sr., Bert, Diane, Patty, Carol, Mike, and Lynn, fighting cancers, and Diana, Bobby, Mario, Edward, Bob, and Brenda, for hopefulness and strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you choose us to be witnesses to your love. Bless visitors among us today, those celebrating Pentecost with family and friends, and those who travel during this holiday time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
It is now our opportunity, the members of his family, to share our intercessions, our blessings, and our needs, both silently or aloud.
Please be with those families known to us who have family members who have passed away, especially the Diaz, DiMaggio family, and the Carter family. Be with these folks and comfort them and let them know that their loved ones are in paradise with you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, in regard to Susan Tapia, may her blood conform to laboratory results necessary for receiving anticoagulants because she has had some strokes, and we ask you, your spirit, to go to her now and be her comfort. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we thank you for letting Mary Coleman get through her cataract surgery and doing well. We ask you to be with Joan as she goes into her surgery this week. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you have swallowed up death forever through the resurrection of your Son. Make us confident that we will feast at your heavenly banquet with those who have died and are now at rest. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, by the death and resurrection of your Son, you have granted new life, abundant renewal, and salvation. Hear our prayers for the sake of the one who has set us free, Jesus the Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It is now the time that we will collect our offerings. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings, as you have raised us to new life in Christ. Give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and joyful that with full hearts and voices we should praise you, O God, all-powerful Father, and your glorious Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, for he has ransomed us with his own blood and given us a place in this banquet of grace, our Passover feast. For in his dying he has destroyed death, and in rising has opened to us eternal life. So with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful God, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. This is your hour of triumph in which you make known to us the power of love over hatred, peace over violence, and life over death itself. For in your love you sent to us Jesus, our beloved Savior, who in compassion reached out to the sick, the suffering, and the oppressed, who proclaimed good news to the poor, who welcomed both the sinner and the righteous, and who on the cross gave up his own life as evidence of your unconditional love. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So now we remember his suffering and fearful death. We rejoice that you have granted to him this glorious resurrection, and to all who in faith accept him, eternal life. We await his coming again in glory to wake the dead and grant new life to all who have put their faith in him. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and all the faithful, and bless this bread and cup, praying that in Holy Communion we be united with Mary and Peter and all apostles, witnesses to the resurrection, and all the saints, and so be of one heart with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So we praise you with great joy in our Lord, for through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory belong to you, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us lift our prayer with purity of heart. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus said, I am the true vine. Abide in me as I abide in you. Come to the table of mercy. You may be seated.
Thank you.
us pray. Life-giving God, we give you thanks for nourishing us with the bread of heaven and the wine of love. Jesus, our risen Savior, as you send us into the world, guard us from the power of evil, keep us in unity with all your people, and by your Spirit, move us to testify to your grace in the words and actions, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, you raised our Lord Jesus Christ from death. Lift you up and restore you to wholeness.
Amen.
Jesus the Christ, the Word of life, bless you and send you to be his witnesses.
Amen.
And God the Holy Spirit, who renews the whole earth, refresh you in the gift of baptism this day and always. Amen.
Go in peace and share the good news.